social psychology with an emphasis and specialty in research methods and analysis. So the idea here is that you're going to get to learn today, in about as condensed as I can make it, how to run a human subject study. So the subtitle of our talk today is how to run a study. And this is sort of particular. Obviously, there's different things you can do with modeling, and you can have training examples. But we're going to be talking about actually collecting data for analysis from human subjects. Everybody kind of imagine what that, in your own world, might be helpful for? In a minute. Anybody have an idea of a kind of study that they might like to run with human subjects, given their own research?
Prostate cancer,
okay. And what might be related to prostate cancer?
I think prostate cancer, they're having a cancerous prostate.
Yeah. And removal. So having one versus not having one and cancer. Okay.
Yes.
We'll try to remember that one. So that is an example of a human subject study because you need humans for that, unless you want to do it on rats. But in this case, we'll be talking about studies with human subjects. And I'm going to give you an overview of our lecture today. Just generally, what are we going to walk through? And as our question brought up, is you can ask anything. It might have to do with computer science and how people interact with technology. It might have to do with health and well-being and people living or dying from cancer. All of these questions can be asked using these kinds of methodology. So really, any kind of question that you're interested in, whether it's for this class, for another class in your degree, or just personally you're interested in, you can go ahead and actually create, potentially, a study to find experimental evidence and empirical evidence for the answer to your question or not. So the steps I'm going to walk you through today are, go ahead, this is my presentation, but you can sit next to me, it's fine. We're going to first talk about when you are interested in researching anything, regardless of the area, you need to choose what you're interested in studying. That's why we had our idea of prostate cancer, and I said, and what? You need variables. You need to be able to study more than one thing, prostate cancer and something. And then your next question, which is part and parcel of deciding what you want to study, is how you're going to study it. How are you going to make it concrete? What are the actual variables going to look at? How would you measure if somebody has prostate cancer or not? That would be an example in that of this level of choosing your independent variables and making them concrete. And I have these letters, I, V, and DV. You're going to learn that those come to mean independent variable and dependent variable. Because questions that we ask in science often beg which variable causes an effect on the other variable. And that's why we make a distinction between independent variable and dependent variable, which I will go to in depth. Once you know what you're interested in studying, you can choose your method, whether your method is a correlational research method or experimental method. There are a lot of sub-methods that we're not going to go into today because we only have less than two hours with a 10-minute break in between. So we're just going to have to hit the highlights of the big distinction between correlational and experimental research. And then finally, for your guys' own purposes, I want you to walk away from class today being able to do something. So if you actually designed based on your variables and you chose a method and you had some data, I want you to be able to walk away from this class knowing what kind of statistical tests you could use to analyze your data. Now, this is going to be very brief and we're going to run through it. So if there's any point you guys have a question, please raise your hand. Please stop me. Don't be afraid. And I'm also going to be doing a lot, and this is a big class, but I'm going to be doing a lot of call and answer, a lot of dialogue. If we will get through more stuff, if you raise your hand and just say the first thing that comes to your mind. It doesn't have to be the right answer. But I want to get your guys' opinions and ideas as we go forward. Okay? Everybody good with that? So we're going to start with this idea of choosing your own variables, making them concrete, and learning the difference between independent variables and dependent variables in this process. So we have a study that we want to conduct. We want to study the effect of having a prostate on prostate cancer. That's a pretty easy question. Mm-hmm. We have variables. We have the presence or absence of having a prostate and prostate cancer. We have two variables. Super, super easy and obvious that you would think there might be a relationship between those things, because very evidently you might not get prostate cancer once your prostate was removed. Or if you're a woman and don't have a prostate, you're pretty lucky, you're probably not going to get prostate cancer. So, even with this, it's more tricky. It's pretty easy to identify whether someone has a prostate or not, but when we get to the question of how do we observe whether someone has cancer or not, that actually becomes more tricky. That is an example of the trick and the challenge that it is to operationally define your question. How might somebody say whether somebody has cancer or not, or how bad their cancer is? To identify those cells or not. It doesn't matter what it is. It could be a diagnosis from a doctor as yes, no. It could be the number of, the size of the growth, the size of the cancer. These are different ways of getting at the same question, and you notice that they're slightly different. One is a yes, no, just the doctor says they have cancer or not, versus the size, because of the extent of the cancer. These are different ways of concretely getting at this variable that you're interested in, is the presence of cancer or the extent of cancer. So that is a clear, measurable definition of a construct, and we're always interested in finding one. We can't do science unless we can measure it. Now, as a psychologist, this provides a real challenge, because a lot of things I'm interested in is in the mind, in your guys' mind, in everybody's mind. That's a lot harder to measure than something as objective and obvious as cancer. There are tests for cancer. So as a psychologist and other psychologists have had to come up with more clever ways of getting at a measurement of these things that are in our heads. So I'm going to give you an example, and then I'm going to push you guys to challenge yourself to a little bit more difficult kind of operational definition. So, because when we're talking about asking people, for example, their perceptions of interacting with the technology, how do we know whether they liked interacting with the technology, for example? Well, we have to come up with some way of measuring that. So for my example today, which I will be using recurrently and running through and throughout, is an own personal interest, but it's something that I think everybody can connect to in this room. I hope so. If you're having a problem understanding what I'm talking about, raise your hand. But I'm thinking everybody will understand the idea of belonging with other people. And in my research, we conceptualize, we have this theory that belonging is a fundamental need, just as fundamental as food. Having food in your body is just as fundamental. And this drive to belong, this desire to be with other people, is as strong and fundamental as the desire to eat food. The same hunger, it's just a social hunger instead of a physical hunger. Now again, let me give you some examples of how I might illustrate the intense, pervasive power of the need to belong. Anybody ever been to summer camp? Or other kinds of camp where you were away from your family? Yeah, a few people. You can understand the idea, though. You go away from your family. You're with a whole group, new group of people. Or maybe when you guys came to university, like, oh, wow, all of a sudden, I don't know anybody. That experience may have brought up for you this intense need to belong. What do you do? What's the first thing you do when you get a new place and you don't know anybody? Make friends, exactly. And I don't know if you guys are like me at summer camp. When I went to summer camp, I found that best friend, and that was going to be my best friend forever. Like, we were inseparable. We were at together every moment of summer camp, because that's indicating how well we bond, how strongly we bond with other, how desiring we are of these social connections. But then what happens when summer camp's over? Letters. We didn't have email, so I'm a little kid of writing letters. And eventually my pen desire to belong became really strong because I lost this connection. And so what I might do is go out and make new friends to regain that sense of connection that was lost by losing my pet pal. So that is an example of how fundamental the need is to belong, how it acts like hunger. When we have bonds, and we have closeness, and we have friends, and we have social relationships, we feel pretty sated and happy. But then when we lose those, all of a sudden it hurts, it's painful, it's sad, and we're driven to go and make new bonds. But just like physical hunger, some people are hungry all the time, right? Like some people you're like, wow, you just ate like 5 minutes ago, how do you do that? And other people can go for a really long time, here and there, I'm fine. Maybe more of the former than the latter. But there's also true for need to belong. Some people need social interaction all the time. Some people are very, very important to them to be bonded and be close to others, and some people are a little bit more standoffish. They feel a less intense need to belong when they're not as surrounded by people. They're just as fine as when they are. Everybody has the need to belong. Everybody, even those more aloof people, still need their close bond, whether it's with their family or just a couple close friends. But we get individual differences in the need to belong. So this is going to be our construct today. Remember we said we identify a construct or a variable that we're interested in? Now, just like with prostate cancer, we only have one right now. So in a little bit, I will get you to brainstorm what this might be related to. But before I get you brainstorming about what this construct of need to belong might be related to, I want to show you what our operational definition, or one of our operational definitions, is of the need to belong, and it is called the need to belong scale. And what's nice about this one is it's going to be very obvious and evident. Please pass these around. It's going to be really obvious what I'm measuring here, but go ahead and fill this out as if we can figure out at this moment your own need to belong. So be honest, no one's going to look at it, it's not going to go anywhere, and if you don't know. See, the answers are pretty self-evident, but if you scored high, like fives and fours, on items 2, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, and 10, and scored low on items 1, 3, and 7, then you have a higher need to belong, and vice versa for a low need to belong. You can probably get a sense from filling this out that you have either a higher or low need to belong. Okay. So, just, we're going to go forward. It's more just a sense to you for you to get an idea of how we might go about operationally defining a variable that's inside your head. Doesn't have to be as measurable as number of cancer cells. It's something that we can get at in a different way. So I want you to come up with, and write on the back of this sheet, a possible operational definition, a way of measuring aggression, and a way of measuring depression. So one of each, one example of each. And it could be an observational method, like counting the number of cancer cells. Not sure that works exactly. Or it could be something more self-report, like this need to belong scale. Take a minute, write on the back of the piece of paper, and we'll come up with a couple of things. Everybody's got at least one for aggression. Has anybody not got one for aggression? Okay, great. So those of you that got ahead and got one for depression will rely on you to give us an idea. But does somebody want to share theirs for aggression? What is one way you could measure aggression?
A reaction to a particular situation, like when you are being mobbed or teased in front of a crowd, how do you react? Is sign of aggression?
Absolutely, absolutely. So, and those are, that is a way that we've measured aggression before. One of my favorite studies where they measured aggression is they had somebody bumped and walked by them and bumped them and called them an asshole. And then they saw what they did when someone was in a narrow hallway, like these are even closer together, like this much space. And they're going towards someone, and how close they got to them was a measure of aggression. Because it's much more aggressive to get up in somebody's face than to cede the way for them. Absolutely, that's a good one. What about depression? What can we do to operationally define depression?
A feeling that one gets when things don't work out the way they want, which happens to be unexpected, so they get into depression.
So that's a definition. But the key, and thank you for illustrating this for us, because it's a common mistake, unfortunately, is that's a great definition, but for an operational definition, we need to be able to measure it. You got one?
Ask him a question and make him feel that whatever he wants is wrong.
That might make them depressed. That would be a good way of experimentally manipulating depression, which we're getting to soon. That is an operational definition, yes, but I'm going to also ask somebody if they have a measurable, the operational definition that is just measured rather than manipulated. Because, mm-hmm. Yes, you can manipulate.
Ask them to do something exciting, like playing games or something. If they're depressed, they will not be interested. So. Mm-hmm.
Maybe you can measure depression by the way they talk. If the voice is very low, maybe if their diet has suddenly decreased to a greater extent, if the level of their social interaction has decreased to a significant, these are all the traits which can help us understand whether the person is having a normal routine or there is something peculiar or something depressing about them.
So what everybody's coming up with, or at least you two are coming up with, are great variables that might be associated or indicators of depression. But what might our ground truth for depression be? And how we really know whether someone's actually depressed. Those are ways of measuring indicators that might suggest depression. But what would a potential ground truth for depression be? Like we know if somebody's really depressed.
Multisense.
I wish that was the ground truth. But do you guys, when we're talking about multisense, do you know what we use as our objective ground truth measure of depression? No, that's another indicator or predictor of depression.
The reaction to certain kind of loss.
Sorry?
The reaction to a certain kind of loss, like personal or...
No, we actually just ask people to fill out a survey. It's not like this. It's called the PCL or the PHQ-9, and it asks people 9 symptoms of depression, and they rate the extent to which they have it. Now, that is a problem.
The last time that she or he cried.
Hmm?
The last time that he or she cried.
Yeah, that is one of the kind of questions on the PHQ-9. So it just asks people the symptoms of depression, and overall, the ratings of more symptoms mean that people are more depressed. So that's a very common, but the problem with that is people could lie. They could say, and that's the whole point of having multisense, is multisense might be getting at more truth than this, and so with depression, a common one that is used as a operational definition is a clinician's ratings. Because the clinician can hopefully figure out if the person's lying and kind of see through it, which is what multisense is supposed to do. And so, yeah, that's a great little discussion on the difficulties of measuring depression. I didn't give you guys an easy one. But I will go on to use our example of aggression and depression, is we need an operational definition for both an independent variable and a dependent variable. Let me teach you what an independent variable and dependent variable are. Our independent variable is the variable that we are manipulating. It is the variable that you think causes an effect on the other variable. Now, your idea about manipulating depression and making some people depressed would be, in that case, you would be making depression our independent variable. It would be the one that you think is a causing an effect on aggression. And you can imagine that. If you make somebody more depressed, and you put them in that situation where they're like, face-to-face with the person, because they're more apathetic, because they're more, oh, whatever, they might get out of the way. Because they're maybe less depressed. Alternatively, you might imagine the opposite would be true. They're so agitated, they're so upset, they're gonna get really up in their face, and they'll be more aggressive. So it's an interesting question. But in this case, we've designated that depression would be the variable that we think causes an effect on the other variable. Now, I mentioned manipulating because in an experiment, there's a little foreshadowing of the difference between experimental and correlational design, so that's coming, don't worry. The independent variable is the one that is manipulated in an experiment. In the case of if we just measured people's depression, it would still be our independent variable because we believe it has a cause on aggression and not vice versa. But if we just measured, again, foreshadowing, I'll give you the details, if we just simply measured depression using a scale rather than manipulating it like you suggested, then we would have a different kind of research design, not an experiment, which we will get to in a moment. Our dependent variable is always a variable that we think is the outcome. In this case, we've been talking about how aggression might be affected by depression, so that in this case, aggression would be our dependent variable. It's the variable we think the other variable, depression, has an effect on. And again, a little forewarning, a little foreshadowing, this is the variable that's measured in an experiment. So everybody understand the idea between independent variable and dependent variable? Test it out here. So, we're gonna go on to that in just one moment, but I'm going to use our example to illustrate, our example of need to belong, to illustrate this concept of independent and dependent variable. So, we say we have this need to belong. Some people are stronger in this need to belong, and some people are less strong. So thinking about the people that are super strong in this need to belong, that say things like, I don't like being alone, I want other people to accept me. Mm-hmm. I have a strong need to belong. That's a really obvious question, huh? Mm-hmm. So people that say yes, yes, five to those questions, what would they be more likely to do than other people who are answering low on those questions? Mm-hmm. What do you think?
Visit
friends? Is that what you said?
Visit.
They would be aggressive?
Yeah, I think.
You think that people, so aggressive socially or aggressive like punching someone in the face?
Socially.
Socially, okay. So maybe initiative. They would take the initiative. They would be more likely to walk up to somebody on the street and say, hi, I want to be your friend. Maybe not that quite obvious, a little creepy. But the idea is having more initiative. Yeah, I can imagine people if I need to belong, having more initiative. What else? Anything else you think that people with a high need to belong would do more than other people?
They talk a lot.
Talk a lot. That would be a good variable to study. Talk a lot. You'd imagine that people that say, I don't like being alone, would talk more on average than people that say, yeah, I like being alone. That's a good one. Anybody want to throw anything else in the room?
More outgoing,
yeah. And more of an extrovert than an introvert. I could see introversion or extroversion being positively correlated with need to belong. That's a good one. So today, I'm going to use, for running example, this idea that people with a higher need to belong might be more socially sensitive. So social sensitivity is the extent to which you can read other people's emotions. And you know, some people are really perceptive, like, oh, you seem to be feeling sad today. And other people, it goes right over their head. They're totally oblivious. They have no idea how you're feeling. You could be all teary-eyed, and they'll be like, huh? I had no idea you were upset. So social sensitivity is the extent to which you can read other people and read, in particular, their emotional state. And you might guess, might be a good research question, that people who are in higher need to belong, who are more likely to say, I want other people to accept me, are also more aware of other people's emotions. Guys, buy that as a possible research question. Because these are going to be our independent and dependent variables. Given the way that I set up the question, saying that this social hunger might make us more socially sensitive, which one's my independent variable, which one's my dependent variable? Because we have these two variables, we have need to belong.
Independent,
and what's my dependent then? Social sensitivity. Okay, you guys are on board. But, as I was pointing out, there are two kinds of research methods. And these two research methods, correlational and experimental research methods, as a broad category, map onto two different kinds of research questions. And the kind of research question you ask, based on your two variables, determines what kind of research method you use. Now let me say that again. There's two kinds of questions you could ask, and which question you're interested in determines whether you use experimental or correlational research design. This is an example for our example of need to belong and social sensitivity of one kind or category of research question. And that is the kind or category of research question that involves merely association. We're only interested if the two things go together. Is high need to belong associated with higher social sensitivity? Are people out there in the world who would score higher on need to belong also more socially sensitive? That's one kind of question you could ask. And that's just saying, are these related? Do they go together? When people have higher need to belong, do they also have higher social sensitivity? But there's a different kind of question we can ask, and it has a very important aspect to it that makes it just different. It's about cause. It's about saying, does need to belong cause one to have higher social sensitivity? Because you want to be accepted, you then therefore are more sensitive to what other people are expressing on their face. See the difference here? One is just all you care about is they're associated, that higher need to belong goes with higher social sensitivity. In the second question, it's fundamentally a causal question, and you care, it matters to you, which one causes the other. And these require two different kinds of research methods. Correlational research method is sufficient for asking the first question, But for the second question, you cannot use correlational research methods. You have to have experimental research. You have to do an experiment to ask a causal question. And I'll get to that in a moment, and I will compound this very much. But before I do that, I want to make sure practically you understand. I've foreshadowed it a little bit, but I want to understand practically the difference between if you were going to run a correlational research study versus run an experimental research study, what would the difference look like? So remember when I was doing my foreshadowing and this little thing that hopped up in red that said, foreshadowing warning, I said that there was something different about independent variables and dependent variables in an experimental research design. You guys, does anybody remember? No? You might remember because you came up with the idea of, no?
Manipulating,
exactly. Do you remember whether we manipulate the independent or the dependent variable?
Independent.
Very good, you got it. So, in experimental research design, we manipulate the independent variable and measure the dependent variable. That's the formula, that's how you run an experiment. Now remember our example? We determined that one of our variables, either need to belong or social sensitivity, was an independent variable and a dependent variable. This has already been determined for us because we determined which was independent and which was dependent. So in our example of need to belong and social sensitivity, we manipulate
need to belong
and we measure
social
sensitivity. Very good. Now, what about correlational? Anybody know? I haven't told you, so this is just a stab in the dark. If we manipulate the independent variable and measure the dependent variable in experimental, what do we do with correlational? Actually a trick question. We measure both. You think it might be we manipulate the dependent variable. But in correlational research, because we're not interested in a causal question, we don't care which causes one or the other. We're just interested, does one go with the other? Are they associated? We can just measure both. So in this case, what would we measure for our two variables? We'd measure both. We would measure need to belong by having people fill this out, and then we would have to find some way of measuring social sensitivity, which I will share with you in a moment. So to recombine this and make sure we really got it, my first question that I want to ask is need to belong associated with social sensitivity? What kind of method do I use? Correlational, exactly. And indeed, somebody did. Some lovely scholars went ahead and actually asked this question. Pinkett, Gardner, and Knowles in 1999, I think, asked this question. And that meant they had to come up with an operational definition of need to belong. Oh, wait, look, we have one. They have the need to belong scale. They had participants, a bunch of participants, come into the lab and fill out the need to belong scale. And then what else did they have to do? Some measure of social sensitivity. They chose the DANVA, the Diagnostic Analysis of Nonverbal Behavior, something with an A. And what it was is their faces from the Ekman faces. If you guys know the Ekman faces, this is one of the Ekman faces. They look really old school because they were taken way back when, so they're old school photos. And they were flashed these photos for 1 second. You've seen this much more than 1 second. And they had to choose from 4 possible emotional reactions. And the number that they got correct meant they had a higher social sensitivity. The 4 possible reactions were happiness, fear, anger, and sadness. What do you guys think this one is displaying?
Fear.
You guys have high social sensitivity. This is one of the hard questions. Good job, guys. Well, you've also looked at it for more than 1 second. But that's one of the tough ones. On the DANVA, there's some really obvious ones. There's like, if you miss that's happy, wow, you weren't paying attention. But there are some like this that are a little bit tougher. And usually when I ask classes these things, they're like, anger, sadness? And then somebody will say fear. I'm like, yes, that's fear. But you guys have got it all right. And what Pinkett, Gardner, and Knowles found was that there was a significant correlation. I will talk about what significant means in a little bit. But there is a significant correlation between need to belong scale, so the higher score, so the people that were more likely to say or said higher numbers for, I do not like being alone, I want to other people to accept me, I have a strong need to belong, also got more of these tough faces right. So on the 12 faces that were like, oh, I'm not sure, they got more of them correct. So we can say that people with higher need to belong are more socially sensitive. Now, this correlation seems to just be like, okay, well, she's telling me that's what it says. Why does a correlation of 0.38 mean that people with a higher need to belong are more socially sensitive? Well, let's decompose it. This is a correlation coefficient. Anytime in the statistical results section of any paper that you see an R equals, it means it's a correlation coefficient, often called a Pearson's correlation coefficient because he's the dude that discovered it or calculated it or whatnot. And it has several ways of reading it. There's parts to break down. Just the mere fact that there's an R tells you it's a correlation coefficient. The fact that it has a certain number will tell you the strength of that relationship. Higher numbers mean that there's a closer relationship, more tightly associated between the two variables. So a zero means there's no correlation. Like, how about intelligence and shoe size? Zero correlation. No effects whatsoever. Intelligent people have no bigger or smaller shoes. Okay? That means there's no association. The strength of the relationship is null, nothing, zero. Whereas a perfect correlation would be a correlation of one, such as assuming you have correct measurement instruments, temperature in Fahrenheit and temperature in Celsius. Those are perfectly correlated. Those are exactly the same things, so they vary exactly with each other. So these are the extent to which two variables go together. Shoe size and intelligence do not go together at all, and temperature and temperature go together perfectly. So, backing up a minute, what do you guys think about this? How well do these go together? A little bit, yeah, a moderate amount. And indeed, a correlation of 0.38 or 0.4, round up a little, is a moderate correlation. They go together, not perfectly, but also there is an association. It's not like shoe size and intelligence. They actually do go together. Now, it's important here also that there's a lack of a negative or a positive in this case. We don't show the positive because you assume it's positive because you didn't have a negative sign. And it means that as one variable goes up, the other variable goes up too. It's telling you the direction of the association. So all, you know, temperature as well as these two variables going, one goes up, the other one goes up. An example of how there might be a negative relationship is the gas price, average gas price, with how far people drive for vacation. The cheaper the gas is, the further they want to go for vacation. Make sense? As one goes up, the other goes down. That would be a negative correlation. Okay? So that is how you read a correlation coefficient. But because we've run a correlational research design, all we know is there an association. We cannot say anything about causality. We cannot say from this study that Pickett, Gardner, and Knowles ran that need to belong causes social sensitivity. Anybody know why not? Any guesses?
Because it could be the other also.
It could be the other also, exactly. And that is called the directionality problem. That is one of the two problems with correlation, why correlation does not equal causation. Now, that is a phrase that you will hear. I will make you say it so it's ingrained in your brain. Everybody, correlation does not equal causation. Oh, that was terrible. Come on. Correlation does not equal causation. So now in your mind, you will remember, if you see somebody do a correlational research design where they measured two variables and didn't manipulate anything, and they say, this variable, you know, pot smoking causes X. I was like, did you make people smoke pot and other people not smoke pot? You better not say it caused that. That's my favorite example. You see it in the media all the time. Brain size is decreased by pot smoking. Really? Maybe people with smaller brains like to smoke pot. I don't know. So that would be the directionality problem as was brought up. But the other problem, we'll put the directionality problem up there, that yes, social sensitivity could cause need to belong. People that are really, really aware of what other people are thinking could very easily be hyper sensitive and have that desire to be liked. Because if you really notice if people are smiling at you and you know that they're happy with you or not, you might really want to be accepted. Whereas if you're totally oblivious, you may not have that same desire to be accepted. Now, the other one is a little bit more tricky. There are some ways around the directionality problem that I'm not going to be able to tell you about today, but just know there's some statistical techniques that can be done to rule out the directionality problem, even if you have a correlational research design. The problem that you can't get away with in ruling out is the third variable problem. You will always have the third variable problem if you run a correlational research design. And the third variable problem is that there's some third variable that causes both high need to belong and high social sensitivity. Let me give you an example. So we found this correlation of 0.38 between, or not we, but the Gardner and Knowles found this correlation between need to belong and social sensitivity. And they could be associated, or it could be that people that walk into the lab and are like, I like science. I want to be in this study. This is so cool. I'm excited to be here. Score higher on the need to belong scale because they kind of like everything and they want everything to be good and they want other people to like them because they're a highly motivated individual. And then also when they saw those questions, you know, with the faces pop up, they're really trying super hard. So it might just be the people in general who try super hard have higher need to belong because they also try super hard to be liked and they also try super hard on that test of social sensitivity. And my favorite example that I hope you will remember is maybe there's a really hot experimenter. And they're like panting in the back, like, oh, hi there. And so when they're filling out the need to belong scale, thinking the experimenter might read it, they're like, well, I don't like to be alone. Mm-hmm. I have a strong need to belong, yes, oh, yes. All these things, would you like to read my survey? And then when they're seeing these pictures flash on the screen, they're thinking, I really want to impress this experimenter. Maybe if they compliment me on how well I did on it, I might get a date with them. I don't know, that's a little far-fetched, but there might be something else a little bit more reasonable that leads people naturally in the real world to have higher need to belong and therefore also have higher social sensitivity, not because those two things are associated, but because some third variable causes an increase in both. What kind of life situation or life circumstances or something might make people have both a high need to belong and a high social sensitivity, or a low need to belong and a low social sensitivity?
People who are looking for popularity.
Yeah, people that are really, popularity is really important to them. They would say, yeah, to all these questions, and then they would be looking to see if their peers were accepting them or not, and so they'd have to be really good at reading those social cues. How about how many siblings you have? You imagine that if you have zero siblings, you might get used to being alone, and so you have a lower need to belong because you grew up alone, it's okay. And you never learned to really pick up on social cues because there was no one to teach you. That might be another third variable. You can imagine things like that. Maybe a child of divorce has a really high need to belong because they feel like their life was split between two people and they never felt like they really belong with their mom or their dad. And then they're really social sensitive because they always have to, deal with both their parents and make sure they get along, and they're always trying to figure out how their parents like them or like their other parents or what have you. See, there's lots of things, unending, you could go on and on and on to try to come up with third variables that could explain this association. We talked about the directionality problem. And the ultimate problem, as I've been saying, yes, we can deal with the directionality problem with some cool statistical tricks, but while you can measure, you could measure whether someone's an only child. You could measure whether someone is a child of divorce or not. You could measure male-female. Maybe males and females differ in these things, and it's only because females are higher in both that we get this correlation. You could measure all these and statistically rule them out and say, great, all the variables that we measure that are potential third variables don't explain our association. It holds. But there might be one you didn't think of. You do not have all the answers in the world, and there might be some third variable when you run a correlational research design that you forgot to measure, you didn't think to measure, you didn't know could even exist, that could explain them and could be the third variable, and therefore that's why we say no matter how hard you try, correlation does not equal causation. So what we do is we conduct an experiment. about how we want to only manipulate, in this case, we only want to manipulate need to belong and nothing else. And we want to isolate our independent variable so that no other variables differ, so that we could then say that that variable caused a difference in the other variable if we found a difference between our two conditions that differed only in that independent variable. Now the other key part is random assignment here. Why might we need to randomly assign people to conditions, one to a high need to belong condition and one to a low need to belong condition? What might happen if we ask people, which condition would you like to be in? Yeah, you get a bias. You get that, okay, maybe people that are already high in need to belong want to be in the need to belong condition, and then you've lost your ability to rule out those third variables. So if you don't do random assignment, you can't actually make a causal claim. So you must not only manipulate your independent variable and create conditions that differ in only that independent variable, but you can't let people choose who's in what condition, and it has to be random. And that is what we would say. If you do this well, you have internal validity. Your study is strong in internal validity. And then you, once you have strong internal validity, you can be more confident in your causal claim. So once you run an experiment, it's always safe to say one thing causes another. If you have a difference and your experiment works successfully and you have a statistically significant difference, you can say, yes, this causes this. But you want to be careful. Because if you didn't do a very good job of manipulating only your independent variable and you manipulated some other things along the way, which we'll hopefully get to talk about, then you can't really be as confident because your internal validity for that study was compromised. So let me try to think of an example in this need to belong research. So let's say one condition where I'm manipulating need to belong. One way of manipulating need to belong is to reject people, to make people feel like somebody else didn't like them. Like when my pen pal stopped writing me, all of a sudden it's a rejection. And I had this heightened need to belong, and I had to go out and make friends. That's a way in the lab that we can have some people come in, and they're in a social interaction. Let's say you're playing a ball game with somebody else. And there's three people in the room, and the other two people start playing with each other. And that's it. And they leave you out of it. Okay, that could make them have an increase in need to belong. What if, in the other condition, the other person just sat in a room alone? Do you think that would be some good internal validity? Am I only manipulating one variable, or am I manipulating something else? What else am I manipulating?
I think the host society is the people involved here, so.
Yeah, exactly, just the presence of people. Not only have I manipulated rejection, where some person gets left out and the other person doesn't get left out, the other person doesn't get left out because they're in a room alone. Presence and absence of people is another variable you've manipulated. And then so you haven't done a very good job manipulating only one independent variable, and so your internal validity isn't very good. So if you found a difference in social sensitivity between the people who sat in a room alone and the people who played ball and then got locked out of the ball game, then you wouldn't know if it was just the presence of other people or if it was actually the heightened need to belong that they felt because of rejection. So, what did Peggy Gardner and Knowles have to do if they wanted to do an experiment? To study if need to belong cause and effect. On social sensitivity, what did they have to do? They had to do something to do what? Manipulate? Yeah. Yeah, they needed to manipulate need to belong compared to the last study that I showed you of theirs, which was just measuring need to belong. So they manipulated need to belong, and they did so through a writing task. And this way they tried to make things more equal and not manipulate more than one independent variable, because they had everybody do a writing task, rather than some people being in a room alone together and some people being in a room with a group of people. They said, let's try to make it as simple as possible so that we're manipulating only need to belong. And some people wrote about a time they were rejected. They wrote about whatever time came to their mind about when they they were rejected. And this, they had shown in previous research, increases the need to belong. So it takes, if you're a 4 on this scale, it pushes you up to a 5. If you're a 2 on this scale, it pushes you up to a 3. It heightens your need to belong. So that then if you have a bunch of people, and remember, they're randomly assigned to conditions, the people in the other condition just wrote about their walk to school. This has no effect on their need to belong. So if you have people with randomly assigned to one condition or another, I would just go rejection, control, rejection, control, rejection, control, just random. You know, some of you might be here. Some of you might be here, and some of you might be here. This is higher need to belong. And then this is the control condition. Some people might be here, all over. So when I'm randomly assigning some of you to the need to belong condition and some of you to the control condition, I, by increasing these people's need to belong, up to here, 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 you can see that the average need to belong in this condition is higher than the average need to belong in that condition. So by randomly assigning and then manipulating need to belong among some people, I can say that it doesn't matter what need to belong you came in with. I've heightened everybody's need to belong in this case. That means that overall, the people in this condition, in the rejection condition, are going to have a higher need to belong. Make sense, everybody? Okay. And then they measured social sensitivity in a very similar way to the other study. And they found this wonderful chart, which happened to be statistically significant, such that people in the rejection condition were significantly higher in social sensitivity compared to the control condition. So, can we say the need to belong causes an effect on social sensitivity? Yeah, we can. We can say having heightened need to belong increases social sensitivity. Because we ran an experiment. Because we manipulated, or they manipulated, the independent variable, and then measured the dependent variable, we can say we have some evidence for causality. Now, we are right about time for a break. I would like you guys to take a working break. We are going to come back at 3:05. That will be 10 minutes. Everybody have the link that Dr. Scherer sent out? Go ahead, complete that. It should not take you the full 10 minutes. If it takes everybody the full 10 minutes, we will extend our break. Take the 10 minutes, be back at 3:05, and just complete that link as part of your break, if that's okay. Thanks, guys.
Absolutely, I do something, and then obviously, it's going to I'm going to take a lot of conscience calls. It's not their fault. It's just that they're at a wall. They want to try to hide themselves from the
survey last
year.
particularly when there's invaders, they call the troops in. And finally, they just take that out of there. So adjusting for age, these are mortality rates. Males are also die sooner than females. But whether you're male or female, when people feel a low sense of belonging, they feel that they do not belong. So they have this need to belong, but it's going unmet. They have a higher risk of death. Now, this is correlational research. We don't know. Pretty hard for death to cause loneliness. We're pretty sure directionality isn't the problem there. But what other problem could be going on? If not the directionality problem, then the third variable problem. Like maybe health is a third variable. Unhealthy people are lonely. They have their belonging needs going unmet. And they're also at a higher risk of death. Seems reasonable. So we don't know. We haven't ruled out all the third variables. It's still a problem because it's correlational research. But these are real-world outcomes that would be really hard to study with an experiment. And I'll talk about in a minute why it's hard to study these things with an experiment. There's a number of reasons that these kind of things are tough to study using experimental designs. But I want to point out that while we had internal validity about how well you manipulated only one of the variables, didn't manipulate anything else, when we're talking about experiments, both experiments and correlations, also you should consider external validity. It's basically how real world are the outcomes, how applicable to the real world are these things that you're studying. And when we're talking about these big real world outcomes that really matter, they have really high external validity. So there's often a tension between internal validity and external validity. The tighter control you have, the better experiment you run, the tougher it is to study these real-world outcomes. And that's because it's hard to make manipulations powerful enough that they impact these kind of outcomes. How much would you have to make someone feel alone to make them die? I don't know. It's also, would you really want to? Would you really want to, A, if you came up with a manipulation that made someone more likely to die, like making them a hermit? Hermits are, have a shorter shelf life, so to speak, kind of depressing way to think of it, but hermits are more likely to die. Also, abused children have a higher mortality rate. These are terrible things that I, as an experimenter, would never want to engage in, even though theoretically I have to randomly assign someone to go be a hermit, if I could get away with it. You could theoretically do that. You could make that a manipulation, but it's unethical to do so. I think everybody in the room would agree that it's unethical to randomly assign some people to be hermits or some babies to be abused. So don't do it. Can't do it. Let's not talk about that as a possibility. So that's those are very powerful manipulations that, in theory, would affect these kind of outcomes. It would make the children or the hermits more ill, have higher cortisol levels, have higher blood pressure, be more likely to die. Okay, so we could show our scientific point, but it's unethical to do so, so let's not do it. And also, it's not only is it unethical to, you know, make someone be a hermit or make a child be abused, it's also if you really believe that your variable you're manipulating is impacting these kinds of things, like making people fail in school, affecting their immune system, making them die, how ethical would it be to actually do that kind of manipulation because you might have these huge consequences? And remember, in research, at least in human subjects research, and to some extent in animal research as well, we have to care for the well-being, and that the risks that we incur on our participants have to be worth it. And it'd be really, really hard to have a research question that would be worth it to have these kinds of impacts. So when we're talking about human subjects research, we can't forget ethics. And even if I didn't have any ethics, even if I was a mad scientist and would love to do these things, some things you just practically can't manipulate. Like what? What do we not have the power to manipulate? Age. You can't put someone in a time machine and make them go backward. That's a good one. What else?
Gender.
Can't, at this point, we don't know how to manipulate gender yet. Maybe we'll get there someday, and the evil scientist, Dr. Lucas, could like, yeah. And then also birth order. You know, you can't affect and randomly assign children to be born in a certain order. You could take children and maybe randomly assign adopted children, but as far as natural birth order, they're sorry. They either have siblings or they don't, and how many they have, not up to us. So, these are some ethical implications when you're talking about correlational or experimental design. Correlational designs can sometimes have ethical issues, you know, asking people very sensitive questions about personal experiences that you can imagine some that might be very private, their sex life, you know, abuse histories. These kind of detailed questions, even though it's correlational, making people super uncomfortable asking these kinds of questions would raise a red flag, and you'd have to be able to justify why the risk could be minimized to the participants. So not to say that all correlational research designs are super easy to get away with without any ethical quandaries or conundrums, but certainly experiments you can imagine would be more difficult to do, and we have to be very careful about the ethical implications and the ethical balance between wanting to do science and wanting to do it in an ethical way. So as promised, very important, you gotta walk away with something practical to be able to do. Now you know how to design your own study to choose whether you want to do a correlational or experiment. Now you have your data. Let's imagine you have your data. You all just gave me some data. Thank you very much. That was nice of you to give me some data. And I can analyze it. But how I would choose to analyze that data depends on something different than our correlational versus experimental research. So let me walk you through that, because it's not very intuitive. And I'll tell you that in a minute. Also, I wanted to point out, don't forget what you just did over the break. We will be going back to that data. I didn't just get data for myself. I got it to share with you guys, and so we will be coming back to that, so keep that in your mind. So we did that. We'll just go to this. Okay, so we'll talk in a minute, a little bit about the data we collected, but to go forward and foreshadow, there were two groups. You guys had two different experiences in here. Some people were randomly assigned to one condition, and other people were randomly assigned to the other condition. What was one thing that somebody might have experienced? When you went through it, what did you experience? Somebody tell me what their experience was like. Yeah?
Yeah, I was told that it's going to be, like, by mid-20s, I'm going to be totally alone for the rest of my life.
Stop. Good thing you're an experiment and that's a bunch of crap. Did everybody have that experience, though?
No.
What else did... So some people have... Who had the experience of being told that they're going to live a life alone? Yeah? Okay, some of you live your life alone. The rest of you all experienced something different. What were you told? Sorry, what?
It says that you will have rewarding relationships throughout your life.
That sounds a lot better, rewarding relationships.
Yeah,
so instead of living alone, having relationships.
Yeah.
So some people had were told feedback based on their personality, quote unquote, that they were going to be, high in belonging. They were gonna live the rest of their life feeling very high in belonging. And the rest of you were randomly assigned to say that the rest of your life are gonna be pretty lonely. Now, obviously I told you it's random assignment. This is not true, this is not diagnostic. I just came up with some questions and randomly assigned you to give feedback. It didn't matter what you said. You could have answered 7777711114532. Doesn't matter. Your answers on the pre-test had nothing to do, you were just randomly assigned to get one of these feedbacks, which we love doing in social psychology, because then it doesn't matter what you do, we have complete control over the feedback you get. But then you answered some questions afterward. What were the questions that you answered after getting the feedback about whether you're going to live your life alone or with other people? Yeah, are you happy? How you feeling? Your mood, basically. So if I were to just grab your data out of the ether, spinning up there in the network, I would have some numbers. For each person that was in the belonging condition, I would have 6 ratings of their happiness. There's various questions about how happy you are. And then for the people in the life alone condition, I would also get their ratings of their happiness. Are they different? If I just looked at it this way, are they different?
Yes.
Yes? Are you sure?
Yeah.
How can you tell?
They
We want more assurance than just, ooh, look, it looks different. So we have to run a statistical test. You guys know that there are a lot of different statistical tests, right? Can't just like pick out, like for example, let me foreshadow it would be inappropriate to run a correlation coefficient. If I were to say R and give some number that was that correlation coefficient to analyze your data, I'd be doing it wrong. That is not the right statistical test. We have to find a different one that is appropriate for the kind of data we have. Now, it does depend on what you did. The most obvious intuition is that it depends on whether you did a correlational or experimental study. You guys, were you just in a correlational study or an experimental study?
Experiment.
Why were you guys in experiment?
Because the first part was manipulated so that you give a proper study in the second part. So.
Exactly. And I experimentally manipulated your belonging needs, and I measured your mood. So I just ran an experiment on you guys. So, the instinct is, the reason I can't run a correlation coefficient is because I didn't have a correlational study. Because correlation seems like it should make sense. If I have a correlational study, then I run a correlation. No, not right. Seems obvious, seems like it should be the case, but it's not. It does not depend. What statistical test you run does not depend on whether you have a correlational or experimental design. Now there's tendencies. Correlational designs tend to be analyzed in one way because the kind of data tends to be one way than another. Vice versa for experiments, but it's not necessarily true, and I will give you examples to illustrate this point. What it depends on is not experimental versus correlational, but the type of independent variable and dependent variable you have. And there's two types of independent variables and dependent variables. So either independent variable or dependent variable could be one of two things. And so let me reiterate is that you don't analyze your data based on correlational experiment, even though this is intuitive, it is a big no-no. You go back and you look at your independent variable and your dependent variable, and that determines how you analyze your data. So it seems logical that you go from one step to the next and go back, and then nope, you have to go all the way back to the beginning. Think about how you operationally defined your variables, and that will determine what the data analytic technique is appropriate. So, regardless of it's an independent variable or dependent variable, doesn't matter, it can either be categorical or continuous. The difference between categorical or continuous, luckily these are very self-evident labels, they help a lot, because categorical means that something is grouped, and continuous means it's like on a continuum. It's a group versus how much of something. So when you hear the word continuous, think continuum. If you're trying to determine what type of variable you have, ask yourself, can I put these in an order? Can I put them on a number line? Can I put these higher to lower? Or is it really irrelevant to put them at higher to lower? Let me use the example of types of cars. We got, okay, we're at Southern California. We got Mercedes, we got BMW, we got Lexus, we got Acura. Can you put those on a number line? No, those are categories, those are groups. Those are groups of type of car. That is categorical, whereas cost of the car would be continuous. You could put, if you just got a number sign, a dollar sign for how much that car was in, you know, Blue Book value, you could rank the cars and you could put them in order if you looked at how much money they cost. But if you looked at what type of car it was, Mercedes, Acura, BMW, then it has to be categorical because you can't put types of cars on any kind of continuum. Got it? Okay, what's gender? Categorical, either male or female. What is year in school? It can be both. So typically it is considered to be category because you leap from one to the next. It's not like you're like kind of in the middle. But I asked it because it's a trick question, because some people will analyze it as if it's something like age, which is continuous. Even though age, you do all of a sudden leap up, I'm going to change from this age to this age, and all of a sudden I'm a different age. you imagine that there's steps in between even if you don't measure it that way. So you could say you're a, you know, second semester senior, that makes it seem more continuous. So whichever way you'd like to analyze it, a lot of people tend to prefer to analyze things using them, if they can be used as a continuous measure, to use as a continuous measure, because let me give an example of this. So let's say this is self-esteem. And you could make any continuous measure into a category by just splitting it down the middle. And this is the mean of self-esteem for all people at USC. And if you're on this side, you're low in self-esteem, and if you're on this side, you're high. Well, you could do that, and people do indeed just split things into high and low. But that means that this person and this person, totally different. And yet, this person and that person, totally the same. Likewise for this person and that person. When you have something and it can be considered continuous, try to keep it continuous if at all possible. While it can be analyzed as a categorical variable, you lose more data by doing that. So for this choice, if you have 1, 2, 3, 4 years in school, and if you were just going to split people, you know, lowerclassmen versus upperclassmen, you're going to lose data because, well, actually, these people are just as similar as these two people are to each other and these two are to each other. They're only one grade apart, and yet it treats 2 and 3 as totally different. So in that case, whenever you can and whenever it's appropriate, treat something as a continuous variable rather than a categorical variable because you don't lose that kind of fine-grained information. That said, there are exceptions, and I could talk about that at any point. This is something I want you to make sure you write down, because this is what you're going to take away from the class. This is going to help you later. If you ever have to analyze data, this is going to be the clue as to what in the heck am I supposed to do. And remember, I said, what statistical test you use depends on whether you have a categorical, independent variable, and dependent variable. Well, it breaks down exactly like that, such that whether you have a categorical independent variable or a continuous independent variable and a continuous dependent variable or a categorical dependent variable, you can have either one be either categories or continuums, and the combination of the two determines the appropriate statistical technique. So if you walk away with anything, this will be the gem from this class, is that later I can run a statistical test and it'll be the right one, rather than running a correlation just because I know correlations are what you can do. It's only run a correlation when it's appropriate. So I'm going to start filling these in and walking through them slowly. So a t-test is what you would run if you have a categorical independent variable and a continuous dependent variable. So this would be, I have an experimental group and a control group, and then I have something that is continuous for my dependent variable, like height, age, whatever you're interested in. So are you interested in if men and women differ in height? You could run a t-test. Now the problem with a t-test is it can only handle men and women, it can only handle two groups. It can only handle experimental versus control, it can't handle anything else. Whereas you might have another group. You might have people that have been through some training, people who have never been through that training, and people who have been through that training 2 times. T-test won't work because it can only handle 2 groups. So in this case, you would need an ANOVA. So there's T-test is a specific case of an ANOVA. It only works for 2 groups, and ANOVA can handle 2 or more groups. Now, we've already talked about how you run a, when you have a continuous independent variable and a continuous dependent variable, which is common in a correlational design, because you've measured one independent variable and measured the other independent variable, and often when we're measuring things, we like to get them on continuums, so you run a correlation. But just because you measured it, just because it's a correlational research design doesn't mean that it's a continuous. You might have measured something. So for example, you measured someone's amount, the extent to which they say they are liberal, and then you measured whether they voted for Obama in the last election or not. That Obama or not is not continuous, it's categorical. So you couldn't run a correlation on that, even though it's a correlational research design. We didn't manipulate anything. We didn't make anybody more liberal and see what they wanted to vote for. We just saw how liberal people said they were and looked at their voting choice. So you'll have to see what's revealed here, because that would be the appropriate thing, because it would be how much are you liberal and yes or no to voting for Obama. Before I go on to that, I want to point out that you could also use a regression in this case instead of a correlation. The reason you would use a regression is sometimes you might be interested in more than one independent variable predicting your dependent variable. Say we were interested in social sensitivity, and we'd already been talking about how other things might predict social sensitivity, not just need to belong, like the number of siblings you have. If you ran a regression, you could see if at the same time, need to belong and number of siblings predicted social sensitivity. If you have a correlation can only handle two variables. You could only look at need to belong and social sensitivity, or number of siblings and social sensitivity. You can't look at both at once. So that's what makes regression a little bit better than correlation. Moving on. If we have a categorical independent variable and a categorical dependent variable, we could run a chi-squared test. An example of something like this might be driving an expensive car or an inexpensive car. You'd have to kind of split down the middle and say, like, you know, Mercedes versus, so you randomly assign people to be in a Mercedes, or you randomly assign people to be in a
Bentley.
Huh?
Bentley.
Yes. So randomly assign people to two different kind of cars, and then measure them going through an obstacle course. Did they knock over a cone, yes or no? If they knocked over a cone, that would be a yes, no, which car were they in, with yes, no. In this case, or the case we talked about earlier with voting, would be, do you identify as a Republican or a Democrat? Did you vote for Obama or not? And then finally, we were interested in the possibility that you might do this, where you have how liberal you are, predicting whether you voted for Obama or not. That would be a logistical regression. This is the least common. People tend to really like up here these things more, where they have a continuous dependent variable. As I said, you tend to prefer, if you can make something a continuum, keep it a continuum, because it saves data. It makes it so you're not treating people that are very similar not like they're similar at all, and people that are very dissimilar not treating them like they're the same. So we tend to end up with stuff at the top. These are less common, but if you run across where you have a yes-no question as your dependent variable, you can run one of these two. Now, does everybody get a chance to write this down? Because now we're going to be going through some examples and quizzing just to give you some practice, but also because this is what I want you to take away from the class, this skill. Okay? Everybody good? Everybody have it in front of them? Okay. So first, before we run through and practice with your guys' own study that you just completed, let's step back and talk about Pickett, Gardner, and Knowles. Remember, they had a correlation between two variables. What were the two variables they correlated? Need to belong and social sensitivity. They got a correlation. Did they do that correctly? Was that correct? Did they choose the right statistical test? What was their measure of need to belong? Need to belong scale. Is this continuous or categorical?
Categorical.
categorical?
Yes.
Why? Somebody tell me why they think this is categorical. Actually, so these are continuous in that higher scores, particularly because we sum them up. So if you say, you know, 5, 4, 5, 2, 1, and of course it's reverse coded, they're not actually categories. They're a range, a continuum of how high your need to belong is. So it's one of those cases you could make it a category. You could say arbitrarily that people had had a 4, but actually if you averaged these, which is just fine doing, you'd end up with people with scores of 3.52. And someone else would have a score of 3.53. That seems pretty continuous to me. So this is continuous. What about the DANVA? How is the DANVA score? Because that was what they used for this correlation. That was what they used for the measure of social sensitivity. DANVA, higher scores on the DANVA were more what? More on social sensitivity, but how did they get a higher score? What did they have to do to get a point on the DANVA? Exactly. So here, it went from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So is it categorical or continuous? Continuous. So check out your chart. If this is continuous and the DANVA is continuous, was the correlation coefficient the correct thing? Yes, absolutely. Very good. What about this one? Remember, they randomly assigned people to write about a time they were rejected or write about their walk to school. And then they measured social sensitivity in a way that's very similar, slightly different scaling, but very similar to the DANVA where it's continuous, I'll tell you. So what tests did they do? Two groups and a continuous dependent variable. T-test. See where I'm getting this from? Okay, so excellent. Now, the point this I'm even talking to you about these results is because they were statistically significant. You can have there be differences and you can run the right test. It will tell you the difference. It will say the mean of this condition, for example, the mean of the control condition was like, what is that, like 55-ish? And the mean of the rejection condition was 119, 18-ish. It's going to tell you if that difference is statistically significant when you run a t-test. The t-test will give you a p-value. P stands for probability. It's the probability that you would get that difference even if in the real world there was no difference. Because sometimes you can just get things by chance, just by random chance. The people that were assigned to that condition, and da, 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 it just happened by chance. So it's telling you, when you get a p-value, it's telling you the likelihood that you would get this big of a difference just due to random error. Now, as a science, and social science, and all the rest of people that run these kind of statistical tests, we have a threshold that we've all agreed to, or kind of vaguely agreed to, which I'll get to in a minute. It's a little squiggly. But we have agreed to that if a result was 5 times out of 100, likely that many times out of 100, likely to occur by chance. So 5% likelihood of error, that it was just due to error and just due to chance, we're saying that's fine. We realize that about 5% of the time, when something is published, it's just going to be due to error. It was just a false positive. But any more than 5%, we're not okay with. So our p-value has to be 5% or smaller. So p of 0.05 or less, which is indicated by this graph. So we're saying, we make fun of something being like, oh, it's highly significant. That means it's really, really unlikely to be due to chance, and we get all excited. Because it's really not, it's like the 0.01, for example, it means that only one time out of 100 is are you going to get that difference due just to chance? Or the 0.001, one time out of 1,000, it would just be due to chance. Then as we get closer, we say that yes, okay, on the edge of 0.05 is significant. If you get an exact p-value of 0.05, oh crap, one, it's devastating because you're like, well, it's not statistically significant because it needs to be less than 0.05. Now, see how arbitrary that is? It's like, well, what if it was 0.051? Then it would be significant. So then we've done these things where we're kind of like, oh, it's just really close to significance. Or marginally significant, we will say this. Or significant at the less than 0.01 level. And then people, when you're kind of like in the general area of, you know, less than 10 out of 100, you kind of go, uh-oh. Is there any way we can reanalyze the data to make it work? Now, this is being a little facetious and poking a little fun at it. But the whole point is that as a field, we know that the strict line of less than 0.05 is a little arbitrary. So you will see people publish with a p-value of 0.05 or 0.06 and say it's marginally significant. And in reality, it depends on what your editors and reviewers will let you get away with for publishing. But this is to point out that we have a standard for results, whether we will present them and publish them in scientific peer-reviewed journals. They have to be very unlikely to be due to chance. And so this is our standard if we run a statistical test. Have we shown the effect? And if it's not statistically significant, we say, well, there might be an effect, but we can't say. Just because it isn't at the 0.05 level, let's say we had something and the p-value was 0.3. Well, that's not even close to significance. Not 0.03, 0.3. Thirty times out of 100, you get that due to error. That's way too much likelihood of error. We don't feel comfortable with that. Just because it wasn't significant doesn't mean there's not an effect. It could be that you just don't have enough power to detect it. It could have been a fluke in the opposite way, that there really is an effect, but you just, the data didn't work out quite that way. So not being able to say that something's significant doesn't mean it's not true. It's just you haven't been able to show it. Okay, everybody feel comfortable? And even with this, if you have it significant and it is at less than P of 0.05, yay, you can publish it, you can talk about it, but it hasn't proven anything. We don't prove things in science. We don't prove things in social science. We show evidence for them because there's a lot of reasons that it might be the fact, and it could just be due to error as well. So we say that we have evidence. We don't say that we prove things. So let's see. We have just enough time, excellence, to analyze data that is similar to your guidance. Now, to save the time, I was going to take the time to actually analyze your actual data, but that would require me to pull it off the network and all that. I'm going to analyze a sample from the last class I taught using this. And so you guys can see, this is an example of the data. We have a bunch of participants. This is how they filled out. These are their scores, like questions. So these are the people that were told they were alone, based on you, that you will end up alone. These are the people type will have a rewarding relationships, and then the people said how happy they were. Oops, sorry about that. How happy they were, how elated they were, how good they felt, how joyful, how peaceful, all these wonderful things. So I took an average. This person was really not very happy, nor was this person, this person, this person. This person was a little bit happier, that person was doing okay. That person wasn't very happy. This person was actually doing quite well. Now we're getting to the folks that were told they were going to live together. This person is just pleased as punch. Not quite as happy. Yeah, not really particularly happy, really in the middle. So then we have these two groups. We have a group of people who were alone. This looks pretty different than this. But to do so, to see if it's a statistically significant difference, we have to run what kind of test? Your last question of the day. T-test, because we have two groups. It's alone versus together, and we have a continuous dependent variable. Let's run it in Excel. In case you ever want to do this on your own, you simply go to data analysis. This is a plugin. You have to go get it. If it doesn't have it there. Pull up. It is actually a t-test assuming equal variances. Just going to skip over that. You copy your data into here. difference that big. There's a statistically significant difference such that people who were told that they were alone and gonna live the rest of their life alone are more pissed off. Science for you guys, okay. Thank you. If there's any questions, I'm happy to stay after. I don't want to hold anybody up because we are perfectly at 3:50 and you are free to go. But if you have questions, please feel free to ask me and stay after. So thank you guys so much. My email address, in case you think of emails, questions later, is Lucas at ICT.USC.edu. So feel free to email me if you don't have a question right now and you have a question later, even if it's like, which way do I analyze my data?
Thank you.